Vidal Silva, Absolute Radio, we're in the bowels of the London Palladium. It's a beautiful place to be, and I'm joined by Guy and Will from Corbett. How are you doing, guys?
Very well, thanks.
Very well,
all right?
How are you? Yeah.
Wonderful. We've kind of split you guys up, because we did the other two about 5 minutes ago, just to corroborate the evidence.
Yeah, what did they say?
Can you account for your whereabouts last night?
What was I doing? I know where I was.
Okay.
I was actually in a theatre.
Okay.
Watching an amazing play called One Night in Miami about the night after Cassius Clay won his first heavyweight title. And him and Malcolm X and a guy called Phil Brown and the singer Sam Cooke had an evening together in a hotel room in Miami. And it was, no one knows what went on, but it's the sort of dramatisation about what they were doing. And it was absolutely brilliant.
Ah,
I can highly recommend it.
That's pretty
totally
good.
Amazing.
And what did we have for dinner?
What did I have for dinner?
Yeah.
Last night, chicken. Brussels sprouts,
okay.
Roast potatoes.
That's pretty
good.
Christmas
dinner.
Yeah, yeah. Does that sort of fall in line with what they told you?
They were a little bit cloudy on the potatoes.
Yeah,
right.
Okay. So I worry that will be going down in evidence.
Okay.
This will come in
court. Made a note.
Have you seen Making a Murderer? This will come up in court later on. I kind of want to talk about this man's jacket. I mean,
it's
beautiful. It's branded. It's based on the album, presumably, as well.
It is. Yeah.
It's Guy's own design.
Yeah.
Because you're quite into your clothing labels, aren't you? You used to have one briefly, didn't you? Am I right in saying that? Or have
no.
I completely
no.
insane?
Oh, right. Many moons ago, I had a shop.
Right, okay.
Yeah, so that might be where your evidence has just been slightly taken a twist along the way somewhere. That's
I just
all.
Think you look very
did
fashionable.
Did they tell you
that
guys have a...
That's what they said. They said
they're lying.
Okay, that's
lying.
Right,
cheeky.
Let me get a pen. You're playing a show in a much smaller venue than you used to.
Yeah.
How do you deal with stuff like that? Because obviously, like with the big arena shows, it's all about timing and lasers and lights and screens and star jumps and.
I mean, we just have smaller lasers.
Laser pens.
Everything's the
star
same.
Jumps.
Just, yeah. Everything's just the same, but shrunk.
Right. Moderate star jumps
only. Yeah. Exactly.
You must get a kick out of playing slightly smaller venues, though.
Definitely. Mm. I mean, we did a sound check and it's. Just so nice to be in a beautiful theatre where people are close to you, and it sounds different inside these small places. Well,
yes.
it sounds completely different to when you play in the bigger venues, which is nice.
Mm.
So I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah,
I mean, I guess you kind of when you're doing the arena shows, you look behind and you see a massive. Version of your face on a gigantic screen.
Yeah.
I mean, that must never get old. But,
but I'm lucky. I can't turn around because I have to face forwards.
Yeah.
Obviously playing the drums. So I never get to see what's on the screen.
So you can be gurning away.
Yeah, I fear it's probably for the best.
So last time we spoke, I mean, the album, you guys put it on magnetic tape like about a year ago now. Was it almost the day?
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
It must seem like a lifetime ago that you kind of sat down and wrote those songs and put everything together.
Certainly, it feels like we've done a lot since.
Mm.
You know, it was a year ago. Yeah, pretty much. We were just talking about it. We did a TV show about a year ago to the day, and that feels like 10 years ago. But it also feels like it was just yesterday.
Mm.
And you know, so much has happened since then. So yeah, it is quite a strange thing. We've been to however many different countries. We did the Super Bowl. We did the Glastonbury. We did all of these extraordinary, you know, bucket list things, and then here we are, we're a year later, and now we're looking to do another year next year. And, you know, we're so excited about keeping this tour going because we're all having such a great time.
Mm. And the pressure's off a little bit because you can space out the dates a little bit and you get to see your family and stuff.
Exactly. It's working really well.
Yeah. And I hear there's a new EP coming out. That was confirmed by lead singer of Coldplay,
okay,
Mr. Carr.
Good.
So we're all right.
That's
we're
all right.
Clear on that one.
Yes.
It's going to be called Kaleidoscope, apparently.
Okay.
Is it? I know.
Crikey.
Loose lips sink ships, guys.
Absolutely.
We're learning.
Amazing.
But is it okay? Are you kind of free to write on the road? I guess nowadays with modern recording techniques, you can kind of get away with it a little bit more.
Yeah, I don't think the process ever stops, really.
Mm.
And there's always lots of ideas that have been left behind which need to be picked up and worked on.
Mm.
Or there's always songs which get finished, but they don't make it onto the album for one reason or another. So, you know, I don't think we ever go out and do a tour and then have a break and then walk into the studio with absolutely nothing. You know, we always kind of, when we start an album, we've always got kind of a bag full of ideas that are kind of in different stages of production.
Mm. So, I mean, I guess you're going to finish the back end of next year will you be going straight back into the studio and starting the next album? Or are you even thinking that far ahead?
It's difficult to say. We always kind of, when we're planning tours, which are kind of 2 years long, we always kind of have to say, well, and at the end of it, we'll have a break, won't we? And everyone sort of nods in agreement. But by the time we kind of get there, there's always so many ideas and a bit of enthusiasm to kind of create more stuff that, you know, the break tends to kind of get chopped out of the...
you find yourself in a studio going, how did this happen? Yeah. Yeah. I definitely had a week booked in the Seychelles, but somehow I'm in, I don't know, Scotland in a studio. And the last time we spoke, just before the last album came out, you guys were talking about how close-knit you guys still are. And has that hasn't changed over a year of touring?
No, I mean, it's... I've been thinking about this a lot. It's definitely something that we really... have understood about our band, is that we need to all be happy in order to function as a band musically, and as a bunch of people, we all need to be happy and we all need to feel like we're listened to and we're getting what we each of us want, because we know when we were younger, we toured for we'd be away for 9 weeks at a time, we'd all start to lose it a bit, and things started cancelling shows, and that's when you know that there's a problem, and there's a problem with the logistics of stuff. So we've worked really hard to make sure we know how long we can tour before we start to burn out, how long the gap has to be, how many shows we can do in a row for Chris's voice. And so it's just 20 years really of accumulated knowledge about our limits of how we can do things musically, and also how we can remain friends and be really
and
close.
Knowing each other's cues and what buttons to press and what buttons not to press. You could probably compile a pretty good dossier on each other, I guess.
Definitely.
Which we will be taking for our files later on.
Good.
You guys obviously got a lot of love for David Bowie, who we sadly lost a bit earlier on. We lost Prince this year, Leonard Cohen this week as well. Yeah, it's been a stinker 2016.
Yeah.
What are your memories of Cohen in particular?
I'm not by no means an aficionado, but obviously his one of his great gifts to the world is the extraordinary song Hallelujah. You know, I first heard it from the Jeff Buckley version, which is one of my favourite recordings of all time, and then I've sort of since gone back and heard the Leonard Cohen version, and obviously it's a super famous song and it's just beautiful. But he's again one of those people that has been a sort of a fixture. You just always producing music, always seeming relevant and interesting. And you know, there's such a huge, rich catalogue of songs. So it's a great tragedy.
And presumably, in fact, I've heard that you might be paying tribute to Leonard Cohen tonight in the set.
I think Chris is going to sing a little song.